to be very frank, I lost a job to CGI. I said, okay, I need to figure this out. First of all, the car is always the hero.
Of course, yeah.
With our creative background, we learned that the holy grail of locations is the city. And since we built a machine that built cities, we can output cities and say, oh, this is your city and nobody else is going to be using it. You know, I started shooting on film. I have no nostalgia of film. I hate it.
Really?
I get stressed talking about it. Imagine, so, situation is this.
You're stressing me out, Faruk.
Exactly.
If I wanted to create a photorealistic image of a car, how would I do it?
Big box of secrets. You want some of those? Okay, number one.
Hey, Faruk.
Hi, Jamie. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. Final checks. We've got the thumbs up.
Yeah, exactly. We're ready to start. It's like 747.
Let's go. I guess we can get straight in and just start with a introduction of who you are and what do you do. You've been asked this many times.
My name is Faruk Heplevent, and I am the founder at this point, the CEO of The Scope. My background is in photography. The car photographer's life is very similar to, you know, a sailor's life. You're gone 6 months out of the year. It's a great life. You follow the sun, right? It's Cape Town, California, southern France, southern Spain. So all very nice. But nevertheless, you know, you're not home. And towards 2007, CGI started being a reality in the car market. To be very frank, I lost a job to CGI and I said, okay, we need to figure this out. So we started looking at it and I was under the impression when I do CGI, I'm going to have a more organized life, which that's not necessarily true.
How's that working out?
Yeah, not so well, but at least, you know, I see the kids in the morning and I got to take the kids to school. You know, we got into CGI very, very slowly and realized, well, we're not going to be able to compete with, you know, the big players. But with our creative background, we learned that building locations and sets is something where we can add to CG workflow, and obviously also the experience in lighting and camera work. You know, things developed, and then after a while, we realized the car launch, per se, is essentially an area where there's not much discussion whether or not it should be CGI, because first of all, the OEMs stopped building show cars just for shoots. They would build this, you know, build them for car shows, but not for, you know, shooting. And they used to do that. I used to work on those jobs. Now they would spend €1 million to build a car to send it somewhere to be photographed. We kept pushing on the location development side of things to be able to deliver on the launch project. And so that became our specialty. At the holy grail of launch locations is the city. So COVID, you know, helped us to find time to do that, essentially. So,
oh, yeah, the scope, the city.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, interestingly, in the car market, at least, COVID didn't lead to tons of more work. And therefore, we could, you know, work with the core team, work on developing the city thing that we had started working on before.
It's grown into a beast. I heard that you put in a lot more work into it than you initially thought that you was going to.
Yeah.
Is it a team of 10 people, you guys, Faruk?
Yeah, roughly, exactly. So, and it's, you know, they've been busy with it. I mean, not exclusively, but it's about 3 years' time to get it done, and learned a lot, found a lot of ways that do not work. To be very frank, it's all stuff that the game studios are using. I mean, there is no super duper secret sauce. It's more about, you know, getting it done, getting it to work, getting it to perform, to have a scene that is, you know, usable.
So the pipeline, under my understanding, it's Houdini, Maya, and V-Ray 6. You essentially, the Scope City, provide the environments for car manufacturers to show off their car and create. Is it mainly car commercials or is it just for those launch?
We do launches, but we started working with in-house CG studios of OEMs. Some of them have teams of 40 people in-house producing their own marketing assets. But a location is always an input that is everybody knows they need it, but I think it seems to be difficult to get management to convince management, say, well, you know, we need to invest in this. And since we build a machine that builds cities, we can output cities and say, oh, this is your individual city and nobody else is going to be using it, right?
So it's a very bespoke.
Can be.
Provided to a client. Do they ever ask for a replication of an actual location?
We don't offer it, right? So I know there's great scan teams that can scan the city for you, rebuild it and do set extensions and all these things. Yeah, we say it's generic. It feels like LA because what we can do or what we do is source the street layout from OSM data, OpenStreetMap. We learned a lot about cities over the last few years because, you know, the grid is different, the width is different, the lots are different, you know, so that gives you an indication for the feeling of the city. A Californian city feels different than New York, right? For many, many historical reasons. But since our clients don't want to replicate a city, especially they don't want to replicate buildings, because first of all, the car is always the hero.
Of course, yeah, of course.
You know, being generic is a feature, not a bug in that case.
When you're creating these cities, it's all obviously procedurally generated. How do you get quite specific in terms of certain aspects of a city?
You need to keep in mind that we're, you know, looking at the world from a car's perspective. So it's, you know, it's what we call city furniture. So bus stops, signage, advertising, benches, you know, also very different between New York and LA. There is, you know, architectural code in every city. So what you're allowed to build and how you're allowed. But also what OpenStreetMap does is it gives you the footprint of a building and height information. So the Houdini tool reads that and knows, oh, this is this type of building, it's stepped, but we can tell it to randomly assign different types of buildings to it. So we have 17 different arch types of buildings built as, I call it Lego, you know, pieces. So they fit together, they know how to create corners, and then they know, oh, there's another building, so I can have windows, I can have... So this is all the rules that the team has developed over the years. So once you load a map, it starts compiling from the Legos it has. And then you can say, oh, this is cool, I'll keep that. Or you can go in and say, I want a different building, or I only want modern building. There is another approach that we call the centerpiece approach, where you put, you know, you build a city with cubes like you would need it for the shot, and then use the machine to create buildings. So more art directed. I like to have big locations and drive through and find locations. Matthias, our head of CG, he likes to construct shots. It's the same with the clients, right? There's these two different approaches.
Is there elements of people in the team that kind of pre-visualize shots and kind of go and explore to get something quite creative? Or
yeah, I like to do that. I like to encourage Toby that does most of the camera work. And I say, let's have a few drives and just see what you find. Also, there is a difference between stills and film. So for stills, what happens is you find a great location and they're like, okay, this is great, but can I have this? And can I have it? Because every element is so important for the shot. Then it's usually more successful to do what we call the centerpiece approach, where you have like an intersection size of location and use a bigger output of the scope city for reflections or, you know, in the depth, you know, to have the skyline. When we do film, it's usually easier to have a street layout, do car simulations, and then maybe do two outputs of the city, a more modern one, a more, you know, rustic one, and then have the same camera run through the same location. Also super interesting.
When you're working with clients that are so focused on their vehicle, because that's, like you say, it's the hero.
Yeah.
How particular can they get with small details in the environment?
It can happen and we can react. That's how it's set up. We try to create shots that do work if we understand the brand. Again, they focus more on the car.
Of course.
We are spending 30 minutes talking about highlights and rims. That is normal in a normal conversation, which is crazy enough if you ask me as a normal human being. You're like, what are you doing?
Yeah, it's blurry. It's moving. There's foreground leaves going past. Exactly. Come on.
If you think about it, I think the average time to market for a new vehicle, so very smart, very talented people with lots of money behind it have spent 3 years of their life,
of course,
getting the car on the street. They care.
Yeah, absolutely. It's similar in a way to, from my background, working in like film and previews on movies and things. When you're working with art department, you know, they spend so long creating these beautiful sets and props. And, you know, sometimes they kind of, oh, can we have the camera do this so we can hold on that beautiful wall that I've modeled for like 7 months, you know? And then the director's like, well, no, but the art department's like, oh, I just want to show off this thing that I've invested so much time in.
Yeah, I think in a film, there is more, even more talent goes to waste, I'm afraid, right? It just doesn't make the edit, and then you're like, ah.
We never get to see our work on the screen in the end. Obviously, you know, we visualize scenes for directors to kind of go and shoot. But, you know, when we're at the cinema at the end and we're saying to our family and friends, like, oh, we previs this whole car chase on Fast and Furious 6, for example, if you're talking about cars.
Yeah.
Ride or die.
Ride or die.
And they're like, so what is it that you did? I says, we pre-visualized all the cameras, the car chases, all the sequence, and they just didn't get that that's not the final thing. But
it's funny because, you know, if we're invisible, we're successful.
Yes, absolutely.
So I said we're the true men in black, you know? Nobody knows us. Everybody forgets
Nobody
us.
Nobody knows.
We flash everybody.
ladies and gentlemen, if you will, look right here.
You didn't see a thing. Touching briefly on your background, you are a traditional car photographer and you've transitioned into CG, like you said, because you lost a job. Was it a catalyst to kind of, I need to jump onto this?
Yeah, there were, you know, it's like basically pushed my interest, and I was in the right time in my life and career also. And I actually enjoyed the challenge. It was very challenging. Basically, I'm not a very technical person. That's the maybe also another interesting thing about our team as well, because, you know, Matthias is a trained graphic designer, creative director, some are photographers, architects. So we always look at CG with the mantra is technology follows creativity. So first of all, we want to solve a creative thing. And we want to achieve what we just discussed. We do things that are invisible. Photographic, filmic quality, where you say, oh, wow, it's a great shot. Especially having been on location with real paying clients that are not relaxed. You know, I started working at shooting on film. I have no nostalgia for film. I hate it.
Really?
Well, okay, but imagine. So, situation is this. So, a location scout went out 8 weeks ago. Shot the location, drove to a one-hour photo, FedEx two sets of pictures back to Germany, one to the agency, one to you as a photographer. Then they overnight it to the client. Somebody drives to the client, they have a live meeting, no conference calls, whatever.
Right.
But if you don't have a great location scout, it is you have these conversations like, well, okay, I've seen the picture, but you're going to be shooting in 8 weeks, except in the desert, the location is going to change. Okay. Well, nature does that to you. So essentially, you need a location scout with sun chart saying, okay, I put the car there where the sun is going to be the correct position when you come back in 8 weeks. And then, you fly over with equipment, all that stuff. You're on location. You get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, drive onto a dark location, and you wait for the sunrise. But the exposure on 8x10 transparencies takes 3-4 minutes. While you're exposing, the sun is getting brighter. So you have to compensate for the exposure. Once you're done, after 5 minutes, you have one shot, one piece of film.
Fingers crossed.
And you have a creative next to you. He's like, yeah, what does it look like? I'm like, well, I can't tell you because I'm shooting film. So you set up another camera to shoot Polaroid. But Polaroid obviously doesn't have the quality.
It's stressing me out, Faruk.
Exactly.
It's stressing me out.
Digital, I think, was a revelation. You're like, okay, look, you can see it and I have it.
The shoot setup for a traditional car photography sounds as technical as some of the technical stuff on computers these days. You know, just
that's true.
You really need to know your beans to get it exactly as predicted.
Then take all that stuff into the city. it gets even worse. Traffic. You have to stop traffic, manage traffic. The light travels fast. Weather. I get stressed talking about it.
You stress me out just hearing you talk about that. Is there any kind of use of like a volume with LED walls and things, or is that not where you guys involve yourselves in with kind of virtual production with photo shoots where you can turn sets around with a physical car?
We're looking at it, but you know, Scope City is not Unreal ready yet. We're working on that. Since we're not using Unreal for production ourselves, it was never the first priority. But we had a lot of requests because, you know, having a city that you can open in Unreal and use a virtual production environment sounds interesting for people. So we definitely want to do that, you know, be able to offer virtual production studios that solution. Me personally, I was never super convinced of exteriors of cars in a virtual stage because the reflections are not right. Do people see it? I don't know. I don't think so. Maybe I know too much, you know.
With your experience, is it more of a pain to handle a physical car, getting it into location, getting everything sorted for the shoot, or handling a model from the client? Which is more painful?
Obviously, it depends on the client, but most clients have a pretty reliable product information pipeline. And again, it goes back to the creative freedom. Because once you have, and we have a different work stream just to prep cars. So we call it spec check. So we take the car, get prepped, you know, you do turntables and detail shots so you can send it back to the product people. If that process is well managed and works, it's easier than dealing with the real car, especially, you know, in a launch situation. When we did launches with real cars, you know, with the hand-built cars, they would send a technician and two security people. And, you know, I pushed too many non-working cars around location because they don't work.
Really?
Yes.
As long as they show up, there's no engine in it, put it there.
I don't know. And especially in the car work that we have done, it's not very editorial. You have a very specific thing you need to get and a very specific angle because the designer has a favorite angle.
It's like, look at it from its good side.
What we usually do is when we know the favorite angle of the designer, I set it up and lock it, right? I rigged it because I had the camera and car rigged, but I can move through the location, always keeping the right angle. And then I see it in light in the IPR, which is very fast these days. So it's obviously much more comfortable than doing that on location, than waiting for the sun to be at the right position and, you know, all these things.
You can move it yourself wherever
exactly.
You want.
Exactly.
If I wanted to create a photorealistic image of a car in a city or a video, how would I do it? What are the tips to get that done?
Big box of secrets. You want some of those? Okay.
Five
secrets.
You have to ask me nicely.
The car angle, number one.
Sure.
This is what you build it around, so be sure you have good angles. Next thing is try to do realistic stuff. So it's like drives in the lane, or if you want to be crossing the lane, make sure it makes sense, right, for your shot. Next thing for us is the closer to the car, the more important. So our streets compared to our buildings have received much more love.
Down on the level of the cars.
Exactly. You know, manholes, asphalt, you know, the markings on the road and how much usage, that, you know, how used they are, what colors. If you're using V-Ray 6, I would strongly suggest to do that because one of the best features, and that's something I've been waiting for a very long time, is the sky system. Because for cars, if you can control the sky, not only the sun position, the colors, but you know, the clouds very precisely, it's a huge, huge part of car photography, even in the city. And then the next thing that I think gives you the final fairy dust is working with the atmosphere very diligently. So you can do bolometric or the what is the other one called? But you know, it's essentially like the dust in the air that you can control. And if you set these up and test them properly,
to a point where they exist, but they don't disturb you. They're not in your face. This is what really, really makes it lively. And don't, you know, clean it up too much. Like every art piece, I'm sure it's the same in what you're doing. You need to focus very closely and then really zoom out. And sometimes leaving it alone for a night is a good idea and come back.
Yeah, great, great piece of advice. Without giving out too much secrets for the scope, we don't want
to... No, the other secret is every time you step up to the plate, as they say, you need to, you know, get a hit. I mean, that is what makes it difficult. And, you know, you need to get it done in a given time frame under the with the constraints that you have. And I think this is what in every field separates professionals from the amateurs. I mean, it's like a friend who does very good sandwiches, but it takes a very long time.
Ooh, baby.
That's a good one. When you were transitioning into the CG world, was Photoshop ever considered as, if you're a photographer, you can't retouch something because that means you've messed up on the day type thing?
At first I was, you know, shooting film. And, you know, the guys I learned with would shoot film to 0.25 magenta filtered on the transparency. You could take the transparency and print it. That was, you know, that was what was expected. Retouching was not an option, just didn't exist. The best thing you could do, there was airbrushers, right? They would cut out pieces and they would airbrush gradients onto the transparency.
Really?
Yeah. The other photographer I worked for, after that, it was one of the first ones to embrace it and say, oh, okay, I'm going to take five different exposures and put them together and retouching. So it became a style. You know, same thing, doing things that are not possible if you're not using the technology. But he had clients that were, you know, like senior creative directors. They were like, oh, but that's cheating and you cannot photograph, your craft is shit, you know, all that. And, you know, it happened more and more with Photoshop going forward. And it was the same conversations that I experienced in CGI. And they're like, oh, it's in CGI, let's look. No, I can see it. I can feel it. I can see the difference. You know, and at one point, it doesn't make a difference. And if everybody's using it, it gets overused. And then there's this backlash because people overdo it. In the end, it does not matter if you use 8x10 cameras, CGI, whatever. You need to respect the craft and be truthful to perspective. Very basic stuff. And this is, I don't know if it's a generational thing. It's about, you know, it's people who take their craft seriously. If you're like, oh, I want the mountains to be bigger, just scale them up.
Just because you can doesn't mean that you should.
Exactly. Get that discipline into, you know, into the workflow, I think is important. I mean, people can educate themselves, right? But they don't. I don't know how many times I had a conversation where I tried to explain that a lens is not perspective. Perspective is perspective. Lensing is lensing. You know, we're in a niche where we say, okay, you know, the CEO doesn't have that conversation with me. He says, I like it, I don't like it. It's right, it's the dark. It looks fake. So if he says it looks fake, I need to figure out why it looks fake to him. For a long time, I was trying to evangelize people on doing it in CG. It's better for the environment, it's faster, it's safer, it's da, 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 it's more efficient. And then I realized it's like, it's just, it doesn't make sense, you know? If people want to go out and shoot, they will go out and shoot. No, you see the difference, you know, because these are the people who are selling it to the, and you have that, and the next biggest competitor is really bad CGI. Because, you know, if somebody had one bad experience, they're like, no, I tried it, it doesn't work. And that comes from people who oversell and underdeliver. What can I do about it? Nothing I can do about it.
If ever you're in a situation where you're talking with a client and they're on the fence of, do I go shoot it for real or do I go with you guys or the, you know, to do it CG, you have to say, look, yeah, you may have bad experience, but it can look real.
But in a way, we move to a position where I say, if you don't have the basic confidence in our capability, I'm not taking the job because it's an endless horror trip. Somebody's like, yeah, you need to prove it to me. And then when you show it to me, I believe it. I'm like, you know what?
We're not for you. Yeah, of course. That makes sense.
I'm not anti-shooting. I'm doing something else.
What's it like balancing four kids, a business, the scope, wife, everything else? What, how do you manage that?
Again, there is like the being, you know, being here, so to speak, helps a bit. You know, before we started working with China, it was actually okay because of mornings were more family. And now it's a bit much, but it's at the same time with all the technology, I'm doing it here because the mic is here, right? So I could be doing it from anywhere. I can do most of the things I need to do on the iPhone. The only thing I cannot do, I cannot look at the render farm and see progress, you know, it's like, but it's also like, are people watching render farms rendering sane people? I'm not sure. I don't have a real concept of what work-life balance is supposed to be, right? It's like you live, right? And while you live, yeah, you work, it's fine. You know, it's, yes, you need to make sure you spend enough time with your loved ones and, you know, try to exercise. And, you know, sometimes you work more, sometimes you work less, because I'm also very good at doing nothing.
No, I know what you mean. Faruk, I've got a little game to finish on. Just a little bit of fun, just to wrap things up on. It's a very quick game of... So, if it's a real image, it might be photoshopped or it might not be photoshopped. We don't know the exact depths of what's gone into these photos. Okay, just a bit of fun. Okay. Let's go with this first image.
CGI car.
You think CGI car, okay.
Oh, very well done.
Oh, we've got real image here, Faruk.
Really, but it's this. I think the size of the car to the lane width is off.
Yeah, the lane width is off. It looks a very narrow car. I completely agree. And that's what threw me, actually, Steve, this image. I would have said CGI for this. Next one, we have got CGI or real.
That's CGI.
CGI, that is CGI, yeah, correct. What gives this away? Just
the glasses.
Oh, okay.
And the car paint too.
Okay, yeah, you got that one right, Faruk. So the next one is CGI or real.
I say real.
It's a tricky one because there's a lot that can go into these images to get the final result. We're not breaking them down, but...
Can't tell. If it's CGI, it's a very good job.
It is a CGI image. Yeah, very well done. This image, real or CGI?
This could be CGI, and I would backtrack it to the tire pressure.
This is actually a real vehicle with a lot of Photoshop. This artist actually is a guy called Alex McKenzie, I think. He's on Instagram. He's called 85mm. He does a lot of shooting multiple exposures and combines them in post.
But that's why I say it's like, you know, if you have the car data, you're quicker rendering it.
Exactly, yeah. Absolutely. Number five is real or CGI?
CGI.
CGI. We have got number five as a real image.
Oh, it could also be real. It's
really hard to tell. We have got the next one, which is number six. We are saying CGI or real?
Real.
Real. This is... an artist, a CGI artist called The Kaiser. The Kaiser on Instagram, incredible artist, and he's been doing it a very long time. The next one is, number seven, is real or CGI?
CGI?
This is a real car.
Yeah.
See, that looks like the door looks fake to me.
Yeah, the door is a retouching thing.
We have got number eight, CGI or real?
That's CGI. I know it. I know the guy who does it.
Oh, really? Yeah, CGI. Absolutely, yeah.
But you need to know a lot about number plates to say, oh, this number plate, the M is a bit...
Oh, okay. So that's for the number plate police that really analyze number plates.
Yeah. That's
fair. Okay. So number nine is CGI or real?
Maybe it's too much retouching. Could be a real car and retouched a bit heavily.
Okay, so you're saying real car with heavy retouch?
Yeah, I'm saying that.
That is exactly that. So that is, real car. And then the final one, is this CGI car or is this a real car?
It's full CGI, I believe. I can't believe it's not butter. You guys know that? Are you all young?
Yes, we know that, yeah. Yeah, that is of course, work from you guys. It's a CGI car. And final question, dream car, Faruk's dream car that he would love to own, drive, or...
Very difficult, you know.
So, or do you hate cars?
I do not hate cars, but it's more like I fall into love too easily. So it's like every car we're working on, oh, this is a great one. I'm going to order one. Obviously, it's much too early to order. We had a Land Rover until it broke down. Then they told us it's a French engine. I'm like, okay, guys, really? It's like, now you're blaming the French. But it's... but right now... We're cruising around in a Fiat 500 convertible. Jaguar F-Type was something I always wanted, but I'm not sure if I can get in and out very elegantly anymore. You know, it's like, I don't want to be the old guy trying to climb out of a sports car. No, if you can't get out very dynamically,
yeah, that's
might not
problem.
Be a good look, you know.
Faruk, that was an absolute pleasure, and I just want to say thank you for your time. That was really great chatting.
Likewise. Thank you, Jamie. Great conversation.
Yeah, really nice. Thank you. Enjoyed it.
Thank you very much for having me.
Pleasure. Take care, Faruk.
Take care. Good evening. Take care. Bye-bye.
All the best.
Bye.